And we'll start part two, Michael.
Thank you very much, Bob. Excellent, Mike here. So I wait until the rest of you come in. And, okay. What we do have in the Billy Meier case, as I said before, is the unique situation of a group experience centered around the contactee Edward Albert Meier, called Billy Edward Albert Meier, but with people who saw UFOs, who saw extraterrestrials, people who by themselves learned it is all true, people who had life-changing experiences. And I'm very happy that we have some of these people here, and that we have some people, we saw some people on the screen who testified in public, in front of a television camera, for Mexican television, and for the video we are producing, what happened to them. Not only seeing some lights in the sky, but having seen Billy Meier appearing just in front of them and disappearing, seeing extraterrestrial beings and having close encounters with the craft, seeing them coming by and flying away before and after a contact. And this is something nobody can ever fake. One part of his Meier experience is his very own son, who from his childhood on experienced everything. Everything what happened to his father he learned about, one way or the other. And it helped him a lot on his own personal way, on the way every young man has to go, the way to find himself, and the way to find a place in life and a mission in life and his own philosophy. And as I say, there's nothing like a Billy Meier teaching, Billy Meier doctrine, there's nothing like a Pleiadian teaching, but man has to evolve and find the truth by himself. Man is independent, man is free, and there should not be doctrines, but evolution and self-realization. And so, when he comes back, and I hope he comes back from the restroom very soon, I'm glad to introduce Methuselah Meier to you. And after Methuselah, here he comes in, okay. Billy the Kid the Second, Mr. Methuselah Meier, welcome in lovely Nevada, in the Wild West, where he really obviously belongs to, and listen to another experience, another very close encounter, which proved the skeptics wrong. He is a part of the Billy Meier experience. Welcome to lovely Nevada, Methuselah Meier.
Hello, everybody. Okay. Now it's better. So I'm happy to be here. So I have now a little problem. I should have a little bit improvised here. About Michael has told very much I like to tell too. So first I would like to tell what I think about the whole story about my father. Some people told that my father is a liar. But my question is, if my father is a liar, why someone would like to kill him? Some people's very afraid about the truth. So truth speaks very, very hard words. And that's the words who tell us the Pleiadians. The teachings of the Pleiadians means that we learn to respect the peoples around the whole world, to accept our next people, to give more love to our next people. So the Pleiadians would like to show us how we can do these teachings, to live these teachings, to find a way how we can learn these teachings. So it's very hard for me to see all the wars and problems around the world here we have now. I mean, it's true that somebody has problems with the extraterrestrial to believe it. But now it's not the time to tell. We have meetings with extraterrestrial peoples more, why they come to us, why they meet us. So my father has so much problems, and somebody would destroy him, why he should do his job again? About it's very dangerous for him, for me too. My father told me, if I come here, I must show that I defend me, that I have secret to me. So somebody told him that someone would kill me too. But I must ask why. No one's, my father or me, would like tell lies or something. So after all them, what you heard from my family, could I say it's a very hard time for me now to speak here. But it's not a easy time for me to stop the contact with my mother. I don't understand her, why he tell lies now. He's one of the peoples who saw the muchest things. He had much sightings. Why he do this, I don't know. The same is like me. I was a little boy. I had my first sighting. It was in Hinwil. I was 2 years old, but I remember. It's unbelievable, but I remember. So at this sighting, my mother was there, my sister Gilgamesh, my brother Atlantis, Hans Schutzbach, and Amata Stetter. My father was going to a contact, and we were staying maybe 1 kilometer from the contact place away. And maybe a half an hour later, my brother was saying, oh, look over there, what's this at the sky? So behind from the wood came a silvery shining disc who flies upper and upper. And Hans Schutzbach was one of the peoples who asked my father on and on, oh, I would like to see them, I would like to see the ships. And my father told, look Hans, it's a problem for you. If you see the ship, you are going so nervous, you couldn't make anyone. You never can take a picture or something like that.
Oh.
Yeah, now it's better. I think I have to high boots. Yeah, now it's better. Okay. So, and this it was right. Hans Schutzbach was seeing the ship and he was walking around very nervous. So before my father was lived to the contact place, he gave to Hans Schutzbach his camera. But it was impossible for Mr. Schutzbach to make a picture. He let the camera fall down. And yeah, it's crazy. He was so nervous, he's going like stupid. We saw this ship more than, I think it was nearly 10 minutes, yeah. And if Hans Schutzbach was a little bit slowlier and easier, he took the camera from the floor, from the ground. But it was only one picture, and on this only one picture was only a very little dark point, not more. So it was true what my father tells him. He's going like crazy. It was my very first sighting, I remember. I have much experiences too. So at one time, I think Asket or Semyazi was coming to meet my father in the living room at my father's house, but only for 1 minute or 2 minutes to tell him something. And I was coming into the door, and it smelled like a very intensive lemon smell, yeah. And at this time I felt the power, the spiritual power from the Pleiadians. I felt the real love. If I was going out from this power field, it was like the world was broken for me. I felt in a deep black hole. I had much days, I think 3 or 4 days, I had problem to clean me up. So that's one ground why the Pleiadians don't have contact with much more peoples or with anyone. It will be the same with anyone from us. So they have a little machine on the belt who makes possible to have contact with peoples who had not so a high spiritual level, but only for 90 minutes. After this time, they must go away. So that's the important one ground why they have contact to anybody. And like Hans Schutzbach, it's the same. If they landing at the public, some people's going crazy. And that's not what the teachings from the Pleiadians says. If you can be war alive, you should be war it, not destroy it. So I have, at my past, I had much problems with myself, about my mother, had to do something wrong things with me. But at the last 3 years, the teachings helped me very much. In Switzerland, I spoke out from a deep, dark hole. Now, I am the one who watches into the hole. I had very much helping from my father. At the years before I changed my thinking and my mind, I was not happy when my father told me, "Look, boy, change your mind, change your thinking." It was not possible for me to believe him. From this time, I have started to thinking about the teachings, to thinking about those things who my father told me I was growing up. I was like a little tree who grows up more and more. I had a time who was not possible for me to speak with you like here, with much people. I was too nervous. But it's only the thinking who made the power. When you changed your thinking, you can have much more power. What I would say, if the peoples on the earth, you and me and everybody, took more love, more accept, more respect to the next people, we can have a paradise on the earth. I try to live what I say. I couldn't say I would respect my next. You see, sure, I'm the son of Billy Meyer, but I'm a pure normal man. But before you can respect the other peoples, before you can have a pure, neutral love to your next, first, you must respect and accept yourself. It's the same like me. I told not what my father says. Another way. My father told me at my lessons what I should tell you. It's my own thing. So it's not possible for me to tell what my father means. I tell my own meanings. So on this way, I can tell the truth. If I tell something who tells me another one, it's natural. Ist das selbstverständlich, dass man beginnt zu lügen? Yeah. If you told something, did you hear it? I mean, make a circle with 10 people. You told one people in his ear, "I have last night drinking one glass beer." At the last people, you had drinking a so big glass of whiskey. That's the problem. And I don't like this. So, on every place, I had lectures, okay, thank you. It was the same. Somebody means I'm a special man, but it's not true. I feel not like a special man. I don't want to be a special man. It's not my thing. I'm not a king. I had a time. My thinking was like this, but I have changed. It was not easy. It's a very hard work to change the thinking. But if you have started thinking, it's very easy to change your mind, to change yourself. I mean, somebody have seen here, I really don't feel like a special man. I talk with anybody. So, but before I can make this, I must come down. Maybe, sure, we have, any people has different spiritual levels. If somebody is on a level like here, and somebody came with a level like here, this one who have a higher level must coming down to this level and to help at the other people who has a deeper level to came up at the higher level. This is the thing we must do here on the planet Earth. What we have now, someone who have macht, what is macht? So macht über andere. Somebody have much power. Money gives power. So if you're not rich on this earth, you are nothing. Why? Those one who has more power, those should help the people who have not so much power. It's on every place the same. How we should have freedom when we don't can have freedom with only three or four peoples? It's not possible. First, we should learn to have freedom and love in a little circle. And then we can grow up. But not only one people should grow up. All together, we should help us to grow up, to have more power, to have the same power. Das heißt Gleichberechtigung. To have equality. That's right? Okay. I told you, it's me. I have not so much money. I'm a pure normal man. But if I can help somebody, I will help. Und wenn es das Leben kosten würde? And if it cost my life. If I see somebody needs my help and I can help, I will help. So that's the meanings of the message from the Pleiades. Sure, I have not enough time to explain all the books who reads my father. He reads 19 books, and in those books he has a universal code. So it's how should I tell you? It's nicht wichtig. It's not important to know the German language. Each people who reads the book, they have a result about this code. It's a special code. I don't know how it goes on with this code to put it in there. I know only the code is there. I saw it by myself. Ich habe den Faden verloren. It's very hard to explain the books who my father reads. Wrote. But you see, my father works very much time on these books. Worked. At 1982, my father, a Nervenzusammenbruch. Her nerve breaks down, and he hits her head 5 times, and he had 8 years to repair. But in this time he read his best work. He wrote his best book called Ohm. It's a very big one, black book, like so thick, so big and so bright.
White,
okay. I'm sorry about the translation, but my English is not so very good.
Relax a minute. Okay, let's let him have a sip of Coke, he's dry, and relax a minute. But I want you to understand that this is the very first time that Methuselah has spoken, has addressed a group in English, any place in the world, without assistance. And he offered to do this the best way he could.
Thank you very much, Wendell. I must have the other sheet. I'm very sorry.
No.
Thank you. So, Michael told you my father has built a group around him called Spiegel. Somebody told the Spiegel and my father makes much money with this story. But it's not true. My father have only, when I right to remember, 700 Swiss francs to live, to pay what he should pay. Every month. Normally family father have maybe 3,500, not more. So my father has only 700. So he can't grow up rich. Or he can't be a millionaire. The Figo, what heißt, ist registriert?
It's registered as a not-for-profit corporation.
Okay. You understand it? Thanks. One part of the money, who took the group from the selling books and photos and video tapes, it's to make new photos or to make copies of the photos, to make new books, new video tapes or something like that. And another part is to pay the taxes from the group to build something, new things on the area around there, or to repair something. I mean, we need tractors too, and they need gas or oil or something, and that's paying with all. I should explain you another way. The group, any member had a Beitrag. Any member has a contribution. They must pay any month, all month, to pay the electric or phone taxes or something like that. It's a very free group, and we have a garden there. My father has a garden with salad and something like that. So it's not true that the Figu has much millions or something like that. It's not possible to be. If he made money with the mission, it will be not the right right way. For him, it's not the right way. For me too. The mission should be to help the people. And somebody, dankbar, somebody should be more grateful to my father or to the Pleiadians to help us, to tell us how we can grow up to a better life. Somebody wish to have more freedom, more love, and they ask, how can I do this? But it's very simple. I told you, respect your next, respect yourself.
Yes, slides.
Slides, yeah. So, I think I told you, I have tell you enough about the message. So I will show you now slides and tell you something about my sightings more.
Took the slides on, please. Who is the man in the shadow?
Das ist ein bisschen schwer für mich hier. Well, okay. I do it on this way. Was heißt Fahne?
M flag.
This is the flag. Long years ago, they have it on a. Okay, it's better. Long years ago, the group has built this flag like the American flag or the Swiss flag. The Fiku has our own flag. This means SSSC, Semyazis Silver Star Center. And Fiku means Freie Interessengemeinschaft über Geistes- und Ufologiestudien.
Free interest group for your
Could you studies. Kannst du es nochmal sagen?
Free interest group for ufological and spiritual studies. That's what FIGU means.
Thank you. Here you see my father, he looks like today. He's now 62 years old. And many people, many times, I see the photo from my father. I'm afraid about the time when he's gone. Was heißt Schatz?
Treasure.
About he's a treasure for me, about teachings. I could go to him if I have questions or problems in my whole life, and he still helps me. And he never told me a wrong thing. Every time he told me something, it was the right way, and it helps me to find an answer what I should do in my life to have a better life and something more. This is one of the pictures at Saddle Ick. Michael Hazeman had explained this photo before. I think I don't should explain more. It's on the same place here. It's the same ship. And my father... It's a...
Was ist ein Grill?
Yeah.
A barbecue.
Here, this one, it's a barbecue for any... an opening barbecue. Anyone could make something on this barbecue.
Did you see this ship?
I saw this ship, but not on this at this time. On a different time. This ship I told you before, a thin wheel, it was nearly the same. So my father took her camera on the top from this barbecue and shot this photo. Yes. From this photo, Wendell has made the analysis about the distance. So the analysis told the result of the analysis that my father has the right size told about this ship here. Is it right?
Yeah.
Okay. It's another one from the same place. It's the same ship. So this one, it's the... This is in Winkelried at 1975. It's the same ship too. And this is in Berg Rumlikon. You saw the movie who the ships jumped away and was coming back. So you see here the reflection from the ground. At the underside from the ship you have here the reflection from the road And from this field, you see here, this one, it's a very
simple film camera.
It's a very simple 8mm film camera. So you see, my father has only one arm. It was not possible for him to make these pictures, to make the film, and have a Route.
A rod.
And have a rod, and in the same hand he has a photo camera. It's not possible to make it. And here you see the reflections from the sun, like from here. So if it's a model, you don't see any reflections, not on the top and not on the ground from the ship. Here it's a very good example. It's a, wie hast du gesagt, Wettertanne?
Of a weather pine tree.
A weather pine tree. It's a, it's one of the most biggest tree we have in Switzerland. So when I don't know, it's a 7 meter or 14 meter ship. And here you see the windows from the ship, and the windows has different colors, and I think if they have the right one color, they see the Pleiadian Sea from the inside of the atmospheric.
If the atmosphere is clear. Yeah. By the way, you should mention, they like these trees, they use the trees as a kind of focusing point for the energy. So the reason why we have, why the object is not shaking on the wedding cake ship footage is that they ground the ships, they combine with the energy of the trees and they use it as a kind of anchor. So that's the reason why when the ship is hovering somewhere in the atmosphere, somewhere in the sky, it is shaking and it is hovering around the trees. And you have a lot of Billy Meyer photos where they use a tree as a focus point.
Thank you, Michael. This one, it's the ship type 3, I think, yeah? It's the same you saw before in the movie from Michael, who shaped from one side to the other side and turns around. And the turning way, it's gegen den Uhrzeigersinn.
Counterclockwise.
So here you see the reflection too. Oh, it's in the wrong way. My father hat das gerne gemacht.
Likes to use reference porn.
Huh? Reference points. My father likes to use reference points. So it's a very good example here to see this ship is very far, I think. 150, 200 meters away from my father, behind this tree. And this one, it's a very good example to show that the photos my father shoots are real. So it's not it's impossible for my father anyway to hold a rod in the hands and make pictures with the same hand. And what's up with three objects? It's more impossible for me. Here we have Aufklärer.
Reconnaissance craft.
Those are reconnaissance craft. And at those ships have very people inside who makes more wider travels. They have different sizes. I knew from 3, 7, and 14 meter ships. So in the 3 meter ships, it's only space for one people. So this type is building to make time travels. At the same time, my father has made a time travel in the future, and he saw the big earthquake from San Francisco and has made pictures from there. I have saw these pictures. So it was anything was destroyed. It was nothing, no one building was there who you can live in. Wann das passieren wird, weiß ich nicht. Das hat mir mein Vater nur einmal gesagt, aber ich weiß es nicht mehr.
In English.
Ow. I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. My father told me the time, but it was very long ago, so I don't remember the time. So if I remember the time, it's not allowed for me to tell it. So you see, it's up from the peoples who live in San Francisco to defend those self. Yeah. So it's not allowed for my father or to me to make the time public. This one is the moped who my father drove to the contacts. You have maybe anybody has seen some documentary film from who Wendell was there, and it was a special one moped. You see, at this side you don't have a brake. The brake was changed to this side. So on this side it's the gas, I think anybody knows. But it was somebody means my father couldn't drive with this moped, but he make much kilometers with this moped. Very much. Here you have an example too. This ship is behind from this tree. And at this time, the ship was very new, and at this time was Semyazi, the pilot. No. Please?
Wendell measured it.
Wendell should know it.
The tree was about...
Please help me.
It was about 80 feet from top to bottom, and it was about 30 feet in width. Not in diameter, I guess you would say, in that case.
The craft
was 30-some feet in diameter, 21 feet in diameter for the craft.
It's got a distance behind the tree.
And it's behind the tree, just behind it.
Here we have an example too, with a tree in the a very little one tree in the front, and you see the focus. Das ist richtig.
And this picture is a very significant picture for two reasons. First of all, of course, because of the mirage, and we spoke about it. But second, you know, you have a little bit of foggy atmosphere. And because of this foggy atmosphere on this day, you can clearly say how far the craft was away. You see, the village here in the foreground is much clearer visible. The edges are much clearer than on the craft itself, which is more in the background and not totally clear to see. So it definitely is far away. It definitely is more far away than the village in the foreground, and it's about the position of the second village in the background, from which we can calculate the diameter again to be 21 feet.
Thank you.
Here the same again. This picture was taken on the same day, and if it would be a model, it would be totally clear and sharp and clear-cut and not dizzy and fuzzy as it is on the picture. This indicates the distance.
So here it's the mirage who we heard a story. This story was going more than a half an hour. The mirage has followed at the Semyazis ship, but at the military station who the mirage came from, they didn't know from something like that. So was ist ein Heißluftballon?
And they claimed it was a hot air balloon.
Hot air balloon.
So after this story, my father has made a hot air balloon, which was maybe 5 meters long and 1.5 or 2 meters high. And on this balloon, he picked some aluminium
foil
to taste what's going on when he starts the balloon. So after he starts the balloon, some jets was starting from the base and was watching and flying around the balloon to search what's up here. So my question is, when they start wegen einem Ballon?
Because of a balloon.
Because of a balloon. Why they shouldn't start because of a UFO? Kannst du mir das übersetzen?
Ist es wahr, dass als das Flugzeug vorbeiflog, das Objekt, das UFO, sich ausschaltete, verschwand und wieder auftauchte an einer anderen Stelle?
Okay, let me answer it because
I'm sorry, Wendell. I'm very sorry that I'm not can explain all by myself.
Okay.
But I'm very happy to have those much help I have here. So you can explain.
the Mirage jet fighter made 22 passes on this object in something like half an hour, the object would either jump out of position and fall back, or it would blink out and blink back on again, changing positions while it's in another dimension. And after the 20-second pass, the Swiss radar ground control ordered the pilot to activate his fire control system to get pictures of it. That also activates the gun. And when he flipped the button to activate the systems, the black boxes in the cockpit began to smoke and melted down, and the airplane broke off the contact, went back to base. They had to change all the boxes in the electrical system.
Hey, bienvenido.
Was heißt das Werk in der Rasse? Das ist
Deus.
Kannst du mir das nochmal sagen? Das ist ein Schiff von einer Zwergmenschenrasse.
This is a spacecraft of a race of dwarfs. So, the big thing on this ship is they can change the color, the size, and the form, shape. So, I don't have this picture here, but it was eine Wiese. Was ist eine Wiese?
A meadow.
Meadow.
There is a meadow. You see it from my father's house.
And you have to work on your accent, okay? You have to pronounce it a little bit slower.
Michael, quiet.
Okay. Okay, let me restart. This meadow. This meadow, it's nearly 1,000 meters bright.
Wide.
Okay. So the
Das Schiff hat diese Wiese beleuchtet.
The ship illuminated the meadow. So it's not possible to illuminate a meadow like this size. How would you make this? At the night, any people had I don't know, maybe someone have seen it, but it can be. So it's not possible. I don't find out how my father should this do, but it's only in one section from the meadow who the lights is going on. And here we have the wedding cake ship. At this,
was ist ein Wohnwagen?
This is an RV behind from a little one tractor. The tractor is only maybe 1 meter, 1.6 meters long. So, and it's orange. And this is a good story. Maybe you should help me at this story. kannst du gleich von Anfang an? Das Schiff damals wurde von Quetzal gesteuert. Ja. She will help me about this story.
Quetzal war damals der Pilot.
At the time this picture was taken, the spacecraft was piloted by Quetzal.
Und durch die Strahlung von diesem Schiff wurde der Traktor von meinem Vater in Mitleidenschaft gezogen. So er konnte den Traktor nicht wieder starten.
And Billy was unable to restart the tractor because the radiation from the spacecraft overpowered the energy of the tractor.
So, und dann war noch, dass das Fußgänger damals dem Kontakt in die Quere kamen.
And some pedestrians who were walking around in the area, they got in the middle of the whole contact.
Quetzal flog einfach weg und kam dann wieder nachher, um den Traktor wieder in Gang zu setzen.
Quetzal was the technical guy as far as the extraterrestrials are concerned, and he took off when he saw the pedestrians. He just disappeared, but then he returned to fix the tractor.
Aber das Ganze dauerte 3 Stunden, weil das ging immer weiter so, dass Quetzal mit seinen Maschinerien aus dem Schiff rauskam, um den Traktor wieder in Gang zu bringen und wieder zurück musste ins Schiff mit all seinen Sachen, musste er zusammenpacken, wieder ins Schiff rein, and wieder davonfliegen und wieder kommen.
The whole thing took at least 3 hours because every time Quetzal came and brought his tools out to fix the tractor, he had to disappear again, and then later on he would come back again to fix it again, and then some more pedestrians came, and that's why it was drawn out and on and on and on.
Das war die Story.
That was the story.
I don't know. You see, I never ask my father about... It's not important for me. I don't know it. Yes, the tractor is at the front from... Yeah, from this caravan, okay.
Can't do that.
Behind here? Yeah, that's here at the back. It's a electrical generator. So he have his own electric machine behind his
was heißt Wohnwagen?
Trailer.
His trailer. No, it's not. It's not a trailer. It's or a camp. Yeah.
Like a motorhome. Like a motorhome.
Like a motorhome.
Like a small motorhome.
It's here. It's at the back from the trailer. And the tractor. It's so little you can't see him. It's in the front from the trailer. I told you it's maybe 1 meter, 1.6 meters long, not more.
Small tractor.
A very small tractor. His drive only 15 kilometers per hour, not more. Second and he drives around with his tractor.
Do you have the audio ready? Yeah. Okay. Good.
Here you have a sharper one picture from this picture you saw by Michael Hiseman.
I think yes. Where is it?
So this ship was building specially for the Earth travel. But
was heißt
Luftverschmutzung?
Pollution, air pollution.
But about the air pollution, it was not possible to make travels again with this ship.
Rost, es begann an zu rosten.
Corrodation started, yeah, corroded, yeah.
After 1 year, it's corroded. It's the same one here, like Michael Hiseman has showed you.
Same time and location when he took the picture. On the video, you even hear the clicking of the camera.
Yeah. So this one, it's the picture who made Edith Beldy again. So it was, wie heißt die jetzt? Von wem war das Schiff? This ship was from Florina. Edith have made holidays with some friends, but Edith don't saw at this time the UFO. So it was a pleasure from her, from ich habe einen Knopf heute.
She wanted to do her a little favor.
Yeah. Do you understand it? It was a pleasure from Florina that Edith can make a picture from her beam ship. So it's a good example too, that not only my father can see the ships. Eine Vergrößerung.
This is an enlargement.
From the same ship.
Of the same picture. And you clearly see the reflection on the left of the ship. And you see it's a three-dimensional ship. And then we compared it with the original Billy Meyer pictures from 1975 and found it to be of the same dimensions. The light and shadow distribution and the reflection on the left fits with the reflection on the ground. So it is definitely not any kind of illusion or bird or whatever. This picture is absolutely authentic.
This one, was ist ein Blitzbesuch?
A very quick visit.
This eine Spur.
This is a trace, a landing track.
This landing track is from a very short meeting in the winter. The ice was 10 centimeter thick. So some stories from the neighbors who saw this landing
track
told my mother has a hacked it out from the ice with a tool. But
actually, generally, the neighbors are very friendly to your father, and this is a very important point. During our investigation, we checked the people living in Hinterschwedröti, and we found that several of them had UFO sightings by themselves at the very same time, or at different times, when members of FIGO saw the craft. So we do have lots of witnesses who are independent from FIGO, who are just from the villages around. Billy himself is very respected. They say, look, we don't know if his UFO stories, whatever it is behind it, we don't know if UFOs are real, but he is such a nice person, and he always is correct in everything he did. He is an honest person, so we highly respect him as a person. So he has a very good reputation in the area around. But when they just moved in this area in 1979, in the early years, of course, people were skeptic about it, but it changed after they had their own experiences. And if anybody goes to Hinterschmiedrüdi or to Schmiedrüdi, just ask in a village pub, which is called Freihof, and you will hear the stories about local people who saw UFOs.
It's the same one. It was Minara. It was Minara who's landing here.
The name of the extraterrestrial lady who came and visited Billy for the short period was Minara, and this is a landing track for Minara's ship.
So, now it's a little bit easier for me. Now we see the spiritual powers, or we see examples from the spiritual powers from my father.
Mental powers in this kind.
Mental powers.
And spiritual, yeah.
Okay. So, at the 21 September at 1978, my father has drunken a half liter rum. It was at one time, not only glass for glass, at one time, X. After them, he took his gun, and it was very late at
11:45, 45, quarter to midnight, 45.
And he goes out and told so many people. So you see here down, it's the peoples are saying this story. So it was
the eyewitnesses.
Yeah, the eyewitnesses. It's Jacobus Bertschinger, Engelbert Wächter, my mother, and this one I don't know. It's I think it's Herbert Runkel. Yeah, and it was
he hit a stamp on 206 meters distance with his pistol. So 600 feet distance. Yeah, a postage stamp.
But no one saw the fingers before the eyes. No one.
It was totally dark. It was in total darkness, the darkest night with no street lamps and nothing. Nobody could even see his hands in front of his face. And in this total darkness, Billy was able to hit the rubber stamp, which was not illuminated, nothing like this, just in the darkness on 600 feet, 620 feet distance. So it's amazing. Try it tonight.
Here it's an example from telekinetic power from my father. This. Is it an oven?
Oven. It's an oven or stove.
This stove is more than 300 kilograms.
700 pounds.
700 pounds.
In weight.
In weight. So somebody would like to change the position from here to here. So the peoples was going into the kitchen and have the lunch, and my father was sitting there on the table, and is very still, ruhig,
quiet,
and he was going like in trance. So it was a couple of minutes after the lunch, the people was going out from the kitchen, and my father told the people, now the job is done. You don't think anymore how to do the oven away. So the people thinking, why? It can't be. We're sitting in the kitchen and eat our food. So he does it at this trance. At his trance, he with his telekinetic power. Was heißt
Spoonbending. That? Spoonbending.
Spoonbending.
Some spoonbending experiments, and as you see, Billy was better than Uri Geller. He did it even with coins. Uri never did it with a coin. Billy did it with big coins, not quarters, but really big European coins.
This one?
Yeah. Like the old silver dollar, yeah, like a silver dollar.
Kannst du mir hier helfen, zum das erklären?
Sure, no problem. Okay, I can do it from here, I have a mic.
Okay. My
Say it in German.
Mein Vater hat das große Geldstück, die große Geldmünze zwischen zwei große, schwere Küchentische eingeklemmt.
My father affixed this coin between two tables in the kitchen.
Und er hat mit seiner Handkante hat er diese Münze fast rechtwinklig abgeschlagen, ohne eine Wunde davon zu ziehen.
And just by touching it with the back of his hand, he transferred, he bent this coin without any scar or whatever, without affecting his hand.
Wenn jemand diese Münze sehen will, ich habe eine auf meinem Zimmer.
If somebody wants to see the coin, I have it with me.
Nicht diese hier, aber eine gleiche.
Not this one exactly, but a similar one from a similar experiment.
Das 2-Franken-Stück hat er in seine Hand genommen und hatte sie zum Glühen gebracht. Das war in der Silvesternacht 1977.
In the New Year's Eve 1977, these 2 Franken, which was like $2 coin, Billy held in his hand and made it glowing in his hand.
Nachdem er das Geldstück zum Glühen gebracht hat, in seiner Hand hatte er einige Wochen danach noch das Brandzeichen in der Handfläche eingebrannt.
And for several weeks Billy had the burning mark on his hand.
Und das ist ein, this is a very...
Not too long ago, as we see from the gentleman on the left.
Was heißt eine leidige Geschichte?
This is quite a tragic story.
So, here you...
Assassination attempt, yeah, is what we are talking about now.
Here you see a little hole, maybe 10 centimeters at the left side from my father.
It's an impact point of a bullet.
Yeah.
An assassination attempt in the presence of Wendell Stevens. Somebody shot at my father, tried to kill him, and it was only 4 inches away from my father's head. It impacted into the wall, and Wendell was present. Wendell was an eyewitness. Can you confirm it, Wendell?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, he confirmed.
My sister Gilgamesh had a short time later found this bullet on the earth. It was the one who should kill my father.
This bullet was supposed to kill Billy. This is the last assassination attempt in June of 1998.
Das zweitletzte.
Okay.
It was one was last year at the 8th. Was ist das?
June,
at the 8th June.
8th of June 1998.
It was a shoot again who should kill my father.
Somebody tried to shoot Billy, yeah.
Yeah.
Did you ever find out who was trying to do that?
No, there was no way to find it out. And in the beginning, they cooperated with the police, but, you know, at the end, this was the 14th assassination attempt. 14.
And this one was the 15th.
And this was the 15th assassination attempt. Somebody threw the knife against Billy.
It was early in the morning, like 4:15 at the morning. So Silvano Lehmann was staying at the front from my father, and my father was on a higher plate. So Silvano Lehmann was with his head. Silvano Lehmann was with his face at this height, who came fly the knife. So if my father not staying there, I think Silvano Lehmann not alive today. So the knife, was heißt Niere?
Kidney, yeah, kidney. It hit the kidney.
Yeah, so my father has blauen Flecken. Einen blauen Flecken, Schmerzen.
A blue spot, a pain spot on his kidney.
And he had much pain. So here too we never find out from which one this knife came. So I don't know why should someone kill my father.
And the handle hit Billy, not the knife, not the top of the knife, the handle. And when the knife was thrown, it turned around several times, and only the handle hit Billy. Of course, he wouldn't have survived this knife entering his body. But, his kidney. But fortunately, only the handle hit Billy. Yeah. Still, they can come close enough in the middle of the night, in the darkness. They can hide themselves behind the trees. This is surrounded by forest, okay? And it's no problem to enter. You know, this is the funny thing about our dear friend Karl Korb. He was afraid to enter the Billy Meyer territory at night because he believes that Billy is surrounded by watchmen, guarded, armed guards, and dogs, fierce dogs. Unfortunately, nothing is true. Every killer can enter the territory at night. Karl Korb describes in his book in this very dramatic, on very dramatic pages, how he at night, by risking his own life, entered the Billy Meyer farm, escaped non-existing dogs, escaped non-existing gunned, armed guards, to take a ground sample of one of the alleged UFO landing sites, which unfortunately at the time when he allegedly entered the territory was not there anymore, it was not visible anymore, so he took a ground sample of a not anymore existing UFO landing spot. I mean, this is really an inventive writer, isn't it? Yeah, of course. Pure science fiction.
So,
but since Billy doesn't have a dog, these people could enter at night.
Yeah. So, here are, I stopped the slides and I would like to
Tell the story.
Yeah. So it was in Salt Lake, it was quite near. It was quite near from my father's house at Hinterschmidrüti. I was with my father, Eva Biri, Engelbert Wächter, Cornelia Wächter. My brother was there, I think, too.
Your mother?
And my mother. My mother has recording the best tape of the sound from the beam ships.
And we listen to it right now. We have it here, and we listen to the original recorded in front of 8 eyewitnesses, the sound of a Pleiadian beam ship. That's what you listen to right now. Please play the audio tape of the Pleiadian beam ship right now.
It was not possible to build this sound with any synthesizer or something like that. So I think I should stop with my lecture here about I can't speak hours and hours.
I don't believe you. Understanding.
Understanding.
Thank you. I thank you all peoples for your understanding about it. It was my first time I had a lesson in English, but my English was not so good. I hope. Yeah, anything. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Methuselah, and thank you for coming the long, long way from Switzerland, from Hinterschmidt-Rüby to here. Thank you. But it's not over yet. Now comes the second highlight of this afternoon, and I'm very happy and very proud that I can introduce a lady to you, which I, in my report on the Maya case in my magazine 2000, called the top eyewitness for the case. And I'll tell you in a moment why. I was just asked to tell you that if you want to get this lady in Beamship Sound, you can get them for $15, I think, at the conference counter of the conference organizers, right here in the hall. Okay, you can get it. Well, I was invited a couple of years ago at a lecture at United Nations organized by Mohammed Ramadan, a senior UN diplomat, and a co-worker, actually, UN co-worker. And after my lecture, a very friendly, nice little lady came to me and said, "Mr. Hesemann, you're from Germany. Do you know Billy Meyer and what do you think about him?" I said, "Sure, I know him and I think he's for real." And she said, "Thank you." And then she told me one of the most incredible stories I ever heard in my life. And the interesting thing about this lady is that not so only she is the warmest and one of the warmest and most spiritual and most wonderful human beings I ever met in my life, and this is a very honest declaration of love for Vogel Song. But she also comes from the political high society of her country of Cambodia. She was a member of the Cambodian delegation at United Nations. She spoke several times to the General Assembly of United Nations about human rights and other questions. So she is a high-ranking diplomat. Her family consists of advisors to the king. Her grandfather was the first judge appointed by the king in Cambodia. Her grandfather has a very fascinating life indeed. He is 111 years old right now. And he looks, and we will see pictures of him, he looked younger when he was 80, and he looks younger now with 111 years than he looked when he was 60 or 70 and just became a Buddhist monk. After being the first judge in her country in Cambodia, this man decided to become a Buddhist monk. And he decided for a spiritual life, and he founded the Ashoka Mission, named after the greatest king of India, the king who introduced Buddhism to India, and under whose rulership India had the peak of its culture. It was about the time of Alexander the Great. And he founded the Ashoka Mission in Delhi. He was a person who had a very close friendship with Mahatma Gandhi. He is such a highly respected Buddhist teacher, but he is on the same level as, let me say, the Dalai Lama. But this is a different way of Buddhism. You have Mahayana Buddhism, you have Hinayana Buddhism, you have different schools, and it's a different school, the more authentic school, because the Tibetan Buddhism is influenced highly by the bone religion, the Tibetan, northern Tibetan demonic cults, and so on and so far. So this is the purest teachings of Buddha, is the Hinayana tradition, and her grandfather is an authentic representative, and he by himself, being 111 years old and being still a teacher of Buddhism and still a monk living actually in your country, is a very shining example of the power of his teachings. When Billy Meyer was a young man, I already told you. He was traveling around the planet by hitchhiking, by foot, by car, by whatever. He did zillions of different jobs, from snake catcher to bodyguard, from driver to veterinarian. And he managed to come to India, where he learned about this famous teacher, and he went into his ashram and became his disciple because he wanted to learn the authentic Buddhist teachings. And this is where he had contacts. And just everyone in the ashram saw the craft. And some people, including this lady, saw Billy Meyer and Asket, a lady from the Dal universe, not from the Pleiades, but from the Dal universe, to walk and talk for hours. So we have an early phase of contact, which you hear nothing about in any of the books with wonderful man Wendell Stevens published, because this was not the focus of their investigation. The focus of their investigation was the Samyasa context, phase three, as I call it, in Switzerland from 1975 on. But the story you might have in mind, that in January 1975, a Swiss farmer went out and saw a spaceship landing and so on, but this is how it all started. It's just not true. It started when he was a little boy of, I think, 5 years of age or something like this, of 5 years of age. And he had contacts for all his life. He was just prepared for the public face, the Samyasa context. And since it was difficult and expensive enough for this team to go to Switzerland and do the primary investigation, they didn't go to India too, because they didn't even know. Nobody knew before, actually, originally Wendell relocated our primary witness. And I announced that as soon as it is possible from her busy schedule, but we will go to India and we will interview several witnesses of this original contact phase, when it was an open contact, when it was a contact people could witness. At the very same time, Timothy Good, the famous English UFO investigator, the most respected British UFO investigator, was in India playing for the London Symphonic Orchestra in Delhi, when he read in the newspaper about Billy Meyer. And this is how Lou Zinstark, the niece of Carl Gustav Jung, the great Swiss psychoanalyst and co-worker of Sigmund Freud, learned about it, and she informed, as Wendell said before, she informed Wendell about the case. So this is where it all began in India. So we go back to the 1960s. We go back for the golden age when it was possible to travel in Middle Eastern countries where today unscrupulous dictators rule. We go back to a time when indeed an open contact happened in 1964, the year in which I was born, in 1964 to India. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to a lady who confessed to me that it was no problem for her to talk in front of the General Assembly of the United Nations, but today she's a little bit nervous because this is deeply, deeply personal, not only because you are the more important audience, but also because what she will talk about now is deeply, deeply personal. It has to do with her life and her path. And after her, we will listen to another very amazing witness of this early contact. Welcome, thank you, Methuselah. Welcome to Lovely and Foreboil song.
Thank you very much. As you said, it is more difficult for me tonight to delve into my childhood and my past and share something very personal and very intimate. More difficult than standing in front of the United Nations General Assembly for 14 years. Defending my country. Not because you have not been a great audience. I think this is one of the most fabulous audience I have ever been a part of. Thank you. It's just my own feeling, because we are not brought up to open our heart to strangers so much, especially dwelling into our past and talking about ourselves. So I'm going to do just that tonight. Maybe I will give you a little background of myself so you have some idea. I was born in Cambodia, in Phnom Penh, Cambodia, and my father, who is still alive and living in the United States, also with me, was an advisor to the king and also a member of the Cambodian cabinet. When I was about 8 years old, my father was sent on a diplomatic mission to India. So our whole family moved to New Delhi, India with him, and I and my brother was put to a school there to study. This will explain how a person from Cambodia ended up in India in a temple that was built by my grandfather in India. Just give you a little background. So after a year, my father's diplomatic mission came to an end. So they moved back to Cambodia, but decided to leave myself and my brother in school under the guardianship of my grandfather. At that time, my grandfather has just found the Ashoka Vihara, or the Ashoka Ashram, as it's now popularly known. He is a Buddhist monk, as you know. This monastery is about an hour and a half from the main center of New Delhi. It's all at the outskirts of New Delhi. And it is a very large temple with six buildings in the compound. I give you a background of the temple so you have an idea of the place and how the ship appears and so on. As I said, there are six big buildings in the area of about, I think, 30 acres, if we could. All surrounded by high stone walls with a lot of hundreds of fruit trees. And I don't have a picture to show you, but I would give you an idea of the area that I grew up in when I was a child. I think we could have the pictures, the first picture. So from 8 years old onwards, my brother, who was about 6 years old, grew up in this temple under the guardianship of my grandfather. Because my parents was not able to be with us, they kind of surrounded us with a lot of caretakers. Like I have an English nanny who taught me English, and I had a Cambodian nurse and a few of the Indian ayahs to take care of us, surrounded by all these kind of like parent figures. And they would visit maybe once a year or so from Cambodia. But in the meantime, these women and my grandfather took care of us. So, not yet. Go back to the first one. I just wanted to introduce to the audience myself, my brother, my grandfather. At that time I was about 9 years old, and my English tutor. And the background is the trees. It's called the Bodhi tree or the people tree. This tree's lineage came out of the tree that the Buddha became enlightened under. So the seedling came from there. the reason I wanted to also bring your attention to this tree is because whenever the ship appears in front of our temple or our area, this tree would become illuminated. Each of the leaves would become quite iridescent, or it's like a peacock feather, all different colors. So one could see that, and I was not the only one to see that. There's many people who live on the terra, and the ashram saw that. Now, the ashram, as I said, is about 30 acres with youth hostels, animal shelters, the main buildings, it's a temple, and with five buildings for residence monk, for visitors to come, and for students of my grandfather who came from Europe, United States, and other Asian countries to study with him. So I have all these people coming in and out of the areas of the ashram. So of course, one of those person who visited this temple was a Swiss person. Now, of course, we all, at least I know popularly, everyone also know that his name is Edward Meyer. But at that time, of course, he was just called Billy Meyer, Billy. Of all the people, of hundreds of people that passed through our place, why I took notice of him? Because we never had any, we never have any conversation. The way I was brought up was not to talk to any strangers, especially male. So I just observed people. And one of the person that I observed coming in and out to my grandfather's room, to the temple area in the evening, or to take classes or lessons from my grandfather, was this person. He has a very unusual eye. I remembered when I was 9 years old, when I first noticed him. Out of all these people, he has this strange eyes that is so penetrating when he look at you or when you look at him, that it goes right to your inner core. This is what stayed in my child's mind at that time. And also, and it makes you sense there's some truth. I don't know why it's like that, but that was what I felt at that time. So I would follow, watch him when he walks, comes to my grandfather's place or... But I'm sorry, I'm jumping ahead of the story because I have to go back about Ascot, how it came about that I took notice of this person. I used to have, when I was 8 years old, my first notice of a visitation was in the evening, late in the evening, when I finished my study with my tutor. I would go to bed. My brother and I share a room, and the ayah will put us to bed, and then they will leave. We would sleep, and then I would have this lady to just appear in the room and would come to me, and then I will fall asleep. The first time it happened, I didn't understand what it was, but it felt so wonderful. I felt I was perfectly at home and was with my parents, although my mother was in Cambodia. But I felt very comfortable, very, very at home, very comforted and peaceful. I fell asleep. A while later, the same thing happened, but this time she would come and pat my head, she would sit at the edge of my bed, put my head on her lap, and I could say, sing me to sleep, but she didn't sing. She didn't use, there was no words. It's not a tone even, it's not a humming. There was some high-pitched tone that was so beautiful to my ear that I would right away fall asleep. And it goes on for a little while like that, and I would ask my brother, who was 6 years old at the time, and he said yes, he remembered, but he didn't He didn't see any being coming to him, but he would sense a presence. So after a while, I would kind of look forward to her coming. I don't know who it was. I don't know it was anybody. All I felt was wonderful and feeling so at home. I didn't know then that it was Asket. There was no name, there was no, but I know that it was a real living being because my head was on her lap. It was as real as my head would be on my mother's lap or human's lap. This went on for quite some time. And then once or twice, it was not right away I would fall asleep, but one, she would sit at the edge of my bed, and then now as I understand it, convey some kind of understanding of messages, and I would just sit there and kind of absorb everything. I didn't read, there was no conversation, but there was conversation going on, as I now know that there must be some kind of a transference, because I understood everything. She told me something that later on I will have more understanding than in later part of my life. And now I do. So stuff like that. And when I would, the next day I would wake up, I would feel, you know, like I understood everything as how the world's come about, how people are the way they are, how this person is happy or sad. I would know that, but that was all that I went through, because that's why I spent so much of my growing up years at that time observing so much, so many people. And that's why I observe people coming in, visiting my grandfather, staying as our guests, and so on. And that's how I noticed this one person who was something different. He was totally different. And that is when, okay, back to, I do not want to jump ahead. So one time I was observing people coming in and out of my grandfather's temple. Suddenly I saw this being now we call Billy, walking. And he was accompanied by the being that used to come and sing me to sleep. So then I know for sure, there was no doubt in my mind that he's also a friend. It was suddenly I see somebody who has been close to me for all this time, walking with somebody who I have always noticed that there was something different about him, together walking. And at the same time that I noticed and became aware of them walking together, I felt that they also knew that I was aware. So both of them turned and looked at me and then continued on in their conversation and so on. And that was, she would come to meet Billy Meyer at the ashram many, many times, and they would walk around looking at areas, looking at the temple, and discuss the teachings, because Billy at the time was, I think, still under the spiritual instruction of Asket. This is how I came to encounter. One of the few contacts, one time she came to my room, and I kind of, it was not a question I asked her, it was just an understanding I transferred to her, saying that this being, he's walking, he's staying with us. I find that he's okay, or something like that. I don't exactly recall, but I know that there was like a telling her or something how I felt about this person. And she said, yes, and maybe there will be more contact later. There will be, your life will have some, there will be some meeting at some point. And that was it. I did not remember any, I did not keep that in my memory, so to say. And by the same token that she had transferred this understanding to me, I also understood that he then could become my friend because she has kind of okayed it. I was only 9 or 10. So, can we have the second slide? I want to show you how he looked when he came to the temple of my grandfather and studied the Buddha's teaching from my grandfather. At one point, he also studied some of the meditation. The Billy picture. This is how he was walking in our compound. He had two monkeys. There's two on the left. One monk, and one he named Emperor Hanuman, and the other one he named Empress Hanuman. The reason I knew this because my brother, you have seen the little boy, was so fascinated with the monkeys that he would run after Billy and play with the monkey. And then he asked his name, and that was why I remember the name, because he told the name of... I remembered that one thing I noticed was that sometimes he had fruits or bananas, he would feed the monkey first. And then he had something left, then he will eat it himself. So that impressed me a little bit when I... So also, as you notice, this is the only picture around that you see him when he still have both arms before his accident in Turkey in the middle 60s or later part of the 60s. The beings that we now know as Asket, how she appeared to me at the time. She has nice long dark hair. She does not look Caucasian nor Asian. It's almost a blend of the two. I cannot describe to you how, but definitely not a Western or Caucasian looking. She does not look Asian. It's almost a blend of the two. She has a very nice golden kind of skin, very luminous and very beautiful to look at. She has long dark hair. That is one thing, because later on when I came to know about the Billy stories, I was shown a picture of Asket. This being looking very European and with long blonde hair. So I asked, then it must not be Asket, what the being that interacted with me, because the Asket that I met did not have blonde hair. So this puzzled me, and I asked a few people. But now, as I'm sure you understand, late now, that the photos that you have been seeing as Asket all along was not her. It was probably, it's a hoax, I was told, is that correct?
It was an exchange.
It was an exchange.
He took the picture of Asket in the station and gave it to a Photoshop for development, and that's what he got back.
Uh-huh.
And he wondered himself why the hair looked so different.
Yes, that was also the question I asked Billy when I met him. I said, But one thing it's true though, she does have a long earlobe. She does have a long, very different from our kind of earlobe. This is another thing I always like to make jokes that she's not very big. She is not very tall, probably 5'1". So I feel quite comforted. But I was a child, and so she was. But so as all these years went by, the encounter with Ascot and the encounter with Billy Meyer at my grandfather's place, he came when he was still seeking and was still before his accident that caused him to lose the arm. He came to the ashram and stayed there for a while. Then later on, when he lost his left arm, he passed through our place and stayed there for a very short while. And the reason I know this was because the gardener of our place, who interacted with Billy quite a bit, made a comment to me that, oh, this is the person that was here before, and now he's back again, but he lost an arm. You see, I have to backtrack a little again to say that when Billy stayed at our place and sight the ships on the ashram and walked around with Ascot, there was other people also that saw the ship. And most of all, our head gardeners, the area used to be, we have a lot of gardens, we have a lot of trees, so people who take care of the land, there were 6 gardeners that take care of the land and 1 head gardener. And he's the one that comes back and forth to report what's happening around the area. One time, Billy was walking around the ashram, and the head gardener came and encountered him and asked it. And the head gardener came and talked to my grandfather and I and said, oh, he's again the same being who has always said that he has been in love with the goddess who came from heaven. You have to understand, in India, the gardeners who are Indians, anything that is out of this world has to do with gods and goddesses. So here you have a Swiss person who stays at our ashram and see ships and take photos, and sometimes people ask what is that, and he would be sharing his stories and they wouldn't understand what's extraterrestrial coming from Dal and universe and so on. They wouldn't understand. They would always take him as telling a story of him having contacts with goddesses from other universe or from heaven. So this is what the head gardener would call him, the person who is in love with the goddess from heaven. So when he returned to the ashram in the late 70s on his way back to Europe, he came with one arm, and that is when I noticed, because he said that the being came back again, but this time minus an arm. I said, who was that? He said, the same being that fell in love with the goddess from heaven. So I then knew that he meant Billy Meyer. I hope I don't jump all over the place and tell my stories, but this is my first sharing of this experience for you. Could I have another picture of